all-new Yamaha YZ450F. Narrower, more compact, and lighter. Built to do one thing, go faster.
Hey everyone, welcome to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. We're joined again today by my buddy Ryan Villopoto. Thanks for coming on. Thanks for coming to our new show set. What do you think of the setup, dude?
I like it. I've seen this building here for
forever, right?
Forever, yeah. I used to drive down the road right here and check, you know, just drive by going to Elsinore.
Yeah.
And then I'm waiting out here for you. I was like, what, man, what building is it? I had a feeling. Green one. And I was like, okay, so, and it's cool to come in here and, you know, see your setup, and then, you know, the guy's got an awesome shop here.
Yeah, we're really lucky to have found a new home. Obviously, Jeremy McGrath gave us a place to live for our first 3 years, and it was a great place. It was awesome to be associated with him and everything, but, you know, we're growing.
Time to be big boys.
You
need your own space.
Yeah, 4 years old now, so I don't know. But before the show, I was telling Ryan that one of our best viewed SML shows ever was the one we did our first show as Swapmoto Live versus Transworld. Yeah, that was when we set up at your race shop.
Yeah, Pro Circuit.
And we said you were coming back for the Nationals and all that. That was good.
April Fools.
Yeah. So I guess thanks for always playing along with us when we want to do something goofy like that.
Yeah.
But so what is what's life for you these days? I know you ride here and there.
Yeah, I've been busy with the kids, obviously.
They're getting big, dude.
Yeah, they're six, so busy with them. All sports, along with moto, we do. So baseball, football, you know, flag, you know, swim, all that mm-hmm. stuff. And then some moto stuff. And then, you know, we're busy with Yamaha. I just picked up my new 23 YZ450 and rode that out at Kauai last week.
Was that your first ride?
That was my first ride on the personal bike I have. I obviously did the bike launch out at the Goat Farm.
Yeah.
Stars facility, which was a lot of fun. And you know, as a whole, I think they did an awesome job on the motorcycle. Mm-hmm. It's plenty fast enough for me. People are like, "What are you gonna do to it?" I'm like, "I'm just gonna throw bars on it, and that's it. I probably won't even do the suspension." It's good. Been busy with that. And, you know, Anaheim 1, as everybody knows, California's crazy and nuts with Anaheim 1, San Diego, mm-hmm. Anaheim 2. Brought the boys to both of those. I went down to San Diego for the day, so that was fun. Get to see a bunch of old faces and carry on some conversation with everybody that, you know, I spent 12 years or more in the industry doing and, you know, racing and get to go see them now on the retired side of it.
It's kind of fun being a supercross, not racing, I'm sure. I mean, now that you're used to being retired, you know, just walking the rig, give away shit.
Yeah, it is. It is. Yeah, it's fun for me. I don't go to a lot of them out of state, mm-hmm. you know. Like, I maybe go to maybe one, two at the most mm-hmm. out of California. So when it does come into California, you know, for the start of the season, it's always a lot of fun. I know it's probably the worst time for most of these guys. You know, I've been in that position, Anaheim 1, all the nerves coming in and, you know, start of the season, things like that. So mm-hmm. But for me, I'm retired, so I enjoy it.
Yeah. Are you going to go to Salt Lake, you think, finale?
I don't know if I'm going to Salt Lake. I like Utah. I like going to Salt Lake. And
dude, you should go to Salt Lake.
Do some mountain biking.
Come a few days early, bring your Moro, dude. The best trails out there, the most fun.
Yeah, I've seen all the stuff, obviously, through COVID when guys were based out there for a couple mm-hmm. weeks at a time. I think you were, too.
Yeah.
There were some awesome trails, and it's a pretty good time of year then. It's like spring, you know, coming into spring. And
yeah, I think right around that time, the snow will be just melted, so the trails are still wet.
Yeah, it looks good.
Yeah. So, okay, so as a Yamaha ambassador, you're obviously on the YDX Moro. There's a new one this year, right? Do you have the new one?
I don't have the new one. No, I actually was. I think they're sold out. You know, like it's for price point of that bicycle mm-hmm. And the components that come on it and everything and how basically how good it is too. Like stability and handling, you know, it's pretty hard to beat that price point. So I still have the original. It's got definitely have some miles on that. Good platforms. I enjoy riding them.
Yeah. What is the last time you rode when you went to Area 51 and did the big jumps?
I think the last time I rode mountain was when we all went up and yeah, hit those big
doubles.
There's
a new bigger one.
I heard there's some bigger ones out there. Yeah, I told Mike the other day, I was like, man, I said, I don't know if I were to go back right now if that one that was the double and then the table down in the hole.
Yeah.
Like, it was easy,
but the timing was scary, right?
A little bit of timing, and like, you know, I go there initially, I'm like, I'll jump everything, you know, and now I'm like, I did it. And you start thinking, I might pass that one up this time. I don't know. Mike's like, no, you jump them. And I'm like, dude, I don't know. I just, you know, I guess dumb when I first go out there and feel like I got to show everybody what's up.
Yeah. Well, dude, you're Ryan Villopoto on two wheels. So come on.
So yeah, but it was a lot of fun.
So Canvas and Zero Two?
Yep. Canvas and Zero Two and also Lucid. Where we're doing the manufacturing side of it. So that's that also, I'm in, pretty involved in that. Mm-hmm. The Zero Two bikes for the e-bike stuff is going really well. And I have the 20-volt kids bike arriving, I think, in 2 weeks. And that's the Flea. So it's a 20-volt version. Mm-hmm. You know, so that should be a really good platform for kids and us. Mm-hmm. With our price point, you know, it'll be right at $499.
How did you get involved in that? Like,
kind of a crazy story. I was getting my private pilot's license, and I was, you know, flying 3 days a week, and a guy hit me up on Instagram, and he's like, "Hey, I want to talk planes with you." And long story short, he was actually originally from up Vancouver, so just across the border from where I grew up, and. You know, at first I was like, man, that's kind of weird. Guy wants to, like, you know, hang out, talk planes. I don't even, you know, through Instagram, I don't know you. So I kind of let it sit for a day or two. And then I was like, all right, let's meet halfway, like go find Starbucks or something and meet. So that's, we got to talking about planes because he's got his private pilot's license. He's got 1,100 hours, Kyle does. And we were talking planes. And me, I guess 6 months into planes or, you know, us being friends, he brought the idea of e-bikes to me. And his background was paddle boards. Okay. And Jimmy Sticks was the company that him and a partner started. And it was price point, good product, but price point boards. So families could afford to buy two or three paddle boards at $899 with the paddle, the board, the, you know, the fins, the bag, the whole nine yards, you could go and get them. And instead of these $2,000 or $3,000 boards. So same concept with our e-bike stuff. We see a lot of e-bikes out there that are well over $2,000. And it's one thing to buy a, you know, a YDX or any major mountain bike that you're going to go downhill or jumping with and things like that.
We're talking like e-bikes that people use for commuting.
We're talking, call it beach cruisers, commuter styles, you know, just for things around the house, around town. You know, over $2,000, that's a big, you know, kind of pill to swallow for something you're not really, you know, training on or using for a specific reason. So our whole philosophy was come in with the price point that families could buy two for the price of other brands. And that was basically, that's what we've built all of our Zero Two off of, was having good product, have it look good, perform well, and be priced well.
So it's your partners?
Like, yeah, I'm partners in it.
Two guys? Yeah, I mean, they're super cool. And it's like funny when you go to a beach town, all you see is kids riding those things everywhere, you know?
It's crazy. It really is. And the growth for that market is, it's huge. I was just talking on the phone this morning about the growth of that and kind of our next plans and what we're, you know, scheduling out some stuff. And it's supposed to be like another 50% growth, you know, over like, you know, till 2030.
Yeah.
And as everybody sees, you know, we know that you know, we know our gas prices right now and things like that. And then for kids, you know, like kids are driving later, everything's happening later, so they're getting an e-bike to go around to school on or to run around town on. So I definitely think it's the growth is there. It's going to happen.
We're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll be back for more with Ryan Villopoto.
We'll be right back.
I'm Aaron Fletcher.
I'm Christian Craig.
I'm Hunter Lawrence.
Josh Moday.
I'm Cameron McAdoo.
I'm Justin Brayton.
Hey, I'm Alvin Muskin.
I'm Malcolm Stewart.
I'm Jalen Ferrangis.
And I choose OGIO.
And I choose OGIO.
I choose OGIO.
I choose OGIO.
Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors here with RV. So let's touch on the Lucid and Canvas deal. I mean, it's exciting because Lucid is the manufacturing brand company.
Yep.
And they produce for Canvas, but they're also making some stuff for other people. I mean, I
Yeah, so we private label a bunch of stuff. So, Lucid is the sister company of Canvas.
Yeah.
And we're producing cut and sew all of our and print all of our own right here in Temecula, right behind AEO. Mm-hmm. And we private label stuff for multiple brands also.
Yeah, some pretty big name brands.
Yeah, some pretty big name brands, and it's going well. Obviously any startup company is kind of hard. It definitely worked into our favor, I guess you could say, with it being that we already had a platform to sell our own stuff on.
Yeah.
Instead of outsourcing that out for up until now, outsourcing the printing and the sewing and all of that, we're able to do that all ourselves now and keep the quality control where we want it, and the timelines where we want it also.
Mm-hmm. It's funny that I'm lucky enough at my lame level to have some sublimated jerseys and stuff from some of our advertisers, but they're so much more comfortable than a jersey with iron-ons. Like, can you remember with that big M?
Big M claw.
Giant number two on your back?
Yeah, that had to be so hot. They were huge, too. Like, the claw was big, and then even my number was even bigger than that. Mm-hmm. It adds weight to it. There's less airflow. Like, it's so much more uncomfortable to wear. I mean, it's little. I mean, it's not a huge thing. But, like, if you have the choice to wear both, mm-hmm. you're always picking the sublimation.
Yeah, did you?
Over the transfers.
Did sublimation get popular towards the end of your career, or were you always an iron?
No, the sublimation got more popular for the jerseys, for sure.
Yeah.
My number eventually went to sublimation, the big two on the back, and then the monster and all the sponsors up front. Just with the evolution, they went away from heat transfers and now into sublimation. And now everybody does it. But a lot of it's done, or most of it, or all of it is done overseas, where we're bridging that gap to do it here. Mm-hmm. And I know there's a lot of, as you probably know, there's a lot of lead times. There's big lead times, across the water. Mm-hmm. And with COVID and everything I think they're still feeling the effects of that, some of these brands.
Yeah.
And we're giving them another option to, maybe we can't make their pants, but jerseys are jerseys. Those are very simple. Mm-hmm. And we get the cut, the fabrics you want, and it's all sublimated, and we can sew it, sublimate it, and get it on shipped out. So it happens really quick. We're up to doing, we have 4 sewers currently, I believe, mm-hmm. And we can do 67 jerseys per sewer. So we can pump out quite a few. Definitely for what we need. We can always scale that, mm-hmm. But right now with what we need, we have 4, and that keeps up with where we're at right now.
Wow. So there's a lot of riders in Supercross wearing Canvas this year.
There's actually quite a few, yeah.
Like, I mean, you got Joey Savacci in it. Like.
Yeah, Joey's been representing, pretty well this year. I think pretty much, he hasn't been far outside the top 10 or been inside the top 10 the first 3 rounds, I think. I don't remember what Houston was for him, but it's good to have a guy out there inside the top 10, running and showing well.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you rode at like Kahuilla Creek or something last week, I think.
Wednesday, yeah.
And that new red set, that looks super cool.
Yeah.
Isn't it funny, like, think back through your career, how gear has changed, right? Like, you were in that gigantic Thor gear.
Yeah.
Remember when gear was real baggy?
Yes.
I mean, isn't it funny to think back at the trends and stuff, and like, pants you've worn in the past that had big plastic panels and stuff?
Yeah, the TPR, all the plastic, the rubber. It's definitely changed. I think... a lot of the athletic fit has come in, probably more ball sports has kind of moved its way into our sport. Mm-hmm. And, we've slimmed up jerseys, slimmed up sleeves. I think that no matter, as you ride and it's just material, mm-hmm. it's, there's no real pads in them. So the lighter we can make the gear, at least for our guys and professional, the happier they tend to be. Mm-hmm. It's cooler, temperature wise. And yeah, it's also safer. You have big jersey hanging down, off the line. You got 22 guys going into the first turn, and it snags on a jersey or it snags on a grip, easily could bring you down. So
yeah.
Now there's some extremes out there with being stuff that's probably too tight that we've mm-hmm. seen on riders. So there is definitely a happy medium. But I prefer the look of today yeah. than the look when I was racing.
It's funny when Steph first got slimmed down in real lightweight stretchy pants, I was like, dude, there's no protection there. Because yeah. you think of the patches as maybe abrasion protection stuff, but like, I mean, I crash all the time, dude.
And
I haven't been like messed up because my pants are too thin or my jersey.
Yeah, no matter what. I mean, we're all riding four strokes now. The pipe is red hot. I mean, it really doesn't matter what material you're wearing. It's gonna melt. It's gonna mm-hmm. burn you. If you crash on Elsinore and it's rock hard, you're gonna have raspberries on your body somewhere. Yeah. So it is what it is. It's part of our sport.
Yeah. Okay, out in my truck right now, before we started the show, I was bringing stuff in. We're still moving from our old shop, but I got this really interesting package from Jason Lawrence.
Oh, really?
Right? So I found these J-Law posters in my van, and I was like, oh. And I remembered the Hangtown incident, right?
Yeah, what was that, 08 maybe?
Oh, man, so long ago.
08, I think.
Okay. I remember seeing it. And it's funny because one of my best friends, Steve Emter, his wife is the one that got that perfect photo of J-Law jumping through the air like a cat at you. But like, I remember seeing it and like, was there some cat and mouse going on?
There's some footage on YouTube, I think, of the whole lead up to that. And he had just, I think him and Dunge just had a major Supercross season where, J-Law was always in, getting in Dunge's head. And I think J-Law ended up winning that Supercross season, maybe yeah. coming into 08. So he was kind of definitely on a high horse coming in there, and I was a favorite for outdoors.
Uh-huh.
And that was his tactic, right? Is to try to get in. He got in Dunge's head, and his next one was to try to get in mine.
Yeah.
And my dad was just, he was like, don't go out and do anything, obviously, to him, but if something happens, like, if he's gonna start playing those games, you gotta play him back, which I was never any good at. Uh-huh. So we went back and forth, kind of pushed him off. He pushed me off the track or came in, screwed with my lap, and then I'm like, okay, my lap's done. So I started screwing with him, and then it led to that, him kind of pulling over a rut or two, and basically just blocking me out. And then I was like, all right, well, what am I gonna do now? clearly didn't think it through that well, and ended up just kind of looping my bike out
into his face.
up it just missed his front fender and came up, and I think the front tire kind of hit him in the chin bar, and then we were kind of locked up, and he dove off his bike on me, and we were rolling around the ground, and then we got pulled apart.
was that like your most intense rivalry through your career, or was it
dangerous? I'd say no, I wouldn't say that was my intent. I said that would probably be my most unordinary or something that
volatile
that could have blown up
yeah.
A volatile situation that could have blown up, but it stopped there. They ended up what'd they do? I think
they made him apologize.
Yeah, and they fined him, and then he got 20 second or then he got 40 second gate pick. Steve Whitelock was the AMA guy at the time.
Was that the same race that he jumped the gate?
I don't think he jumped.
Do you remember that? There was a national where he popped.
Yeah, I don't know if that was it. But so Steve Whitelock was there. It was a big ordeal. I think they fined him 40-second gate pick, and then I think I got a warning.
Yeah.
And then that's it was basically it stopped there. I'd say as for rivalry, I'd say Dunge would probably be the toughest one mm-hmm. over from. I guess basically since once we went 450, he was a player to me basically from 450 up. It wasn't so much of a player as in the lights class. But from 450 on, I had to worry about him my whole career.
Mm-hmm. Was there, any like heated moments with Dungy that like weren't seen by the public?
No, there was never any heated moments with it. Like, you know, you could judge the book by its cover and know what was in it, when you know what you were going to get from Dunge, on and off the track. So that's what was also enjoyable about racing him, because there was never going to be anything that was questionable. Mm-hmm. You know, but he was just a thorn in my side, in a lot of ways, where, okay, I get the whole shot, sprint, I turn around five laps in, because we were laps at this point, turn around five laps in, okay, I got 3 seconds, who's in second, let me look, it's Dunge. Well, then that would make five, I'd still have 15 to go, where I knew he wasn't going to falter one bit, so it made my race feel so much longer, and, you know, you're out front kind of just hanging there, and you're trying to ride quick laps and make sure he's not catching you, but also not ride, you know, put yourself in a position that you're going to make a mistake. Mm-hmm. So it was always a tough one, you know, with him, because till the checkered flag, he'd run you down. Like, he'd run that race, that pace, till the end.
He was like the dog that went.
Yeah, I mean, that's.
Nice. All right, one more quick break to hear from our sponsors. We'll have one more segment with Ryan Villopoto. Welcome back to the SML Show, presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. We were just talking about rivalries. So I remember coming into the truck with you, and you'd always be like, oh, what's Stu doing? You always give me crap for being buddies with James, but how was the rivalry there? Were there any intense moments?
To be honest, between myself, Dunge, Chad, James, I know Chad and James always had a rivalry, and they kind of kept that to themselves. We didn't have any real intense moments between, you know, the three of us, you know, me or the four of us, me, Dunge, but Chad and James would always have some moments, right? But as for James, there was nights you knew you couldn't beat him, and then there was nights that you could expect, you know, a mistake or a crash. And there was some other nights too that I straight up could beat him. I can remember one scenario or one particular race, and he was Canada, and I don't remember what year it was, maybe 2011 or 12. And long set of whoop section, and it came into a 90, and it went back on the start straight back down. And it was main event, and we're coming in, and I don't remember where James was behind me, and he ended up out of the blue just like cleaning me out. So I was pretty pissed. I think it ripped my throttle cable. I was able to finish, but like kind of screwed the bike up. And I pull off the track, and I was pretty heated. I can't say if I was going to say anything then, but I was heated regardless. And here comes Big J. And my dad and Big J were, you know, they weren't like close buddies, but my dad would always talk to Big J. They was always very respectful. Mm-hmm. And I like Big J. And I still today I seen him at San Diego, had a good conversation with Big James. And so that was always cool. But he comes out, here comes Big J. He goes, comes over, he didn't mean to do that. He goes, rear tire kick and the front tire slip and just came in the side of you. And I was pissed. I was just so, and you know, I kind of let it died after that because Big J came over and kind of smoothed it out. But yeah, as for real rivalries, I would say Dunge, really. I mean, Chad, the year that he tore his ACL, I think mm-hmm. we would have had a really, that would have been a tough year. Chad was riding really well mm-hmm. up until I think it was Dallas. But I think I kept my nose out of most of the garbage.
Yeah. One thing I don't know if I ever asked you this before, but remember when you made the jump from 250 to 450, and RL was your trainer?
Yep.
You got really big, but there was.
I think I was.
Didn't you do it on purpose?
I was on the way of getting big prior to that. If you go back and look at actually my last outdoor season in MXON. At Mitch's, like, I was definitely a little pudgy. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, I moved to the 450 class. And let me see. I did a Supercross season when it was up and down, up and, like, bad. And then we came out and raced Glen Helen. And then I tore my ACL at Paula, I say, mm-hmm. right after Glen Helen. But if you go back and look at those photos pre-season coming in, like, I was... definitely wasn't maybe the engine was okay, but I was carrying a lot of some extra weight. I was probably as big as I am now,
but I mean, I remember like asking about then and you're like, yeah, I got to bulk up for the 450.
Yeah,
like,
well,
was that RL strategically
that
telling
was
you
too many all... Cheetos and beer, I think. No, definitely wasn't par for Randy's probably, you know, course. Mm-hmm. I was 21 22. I guess that was the last of the kid power, and it kind of, for me, I had to make a change.
Yeah.
And I didn't. I didn't make a change I made a change in trainers. I think I went from Randy, which was phenomenal for my lights career, mm-hmm. and moved to, let me see, I think it was Jeff Spencer for a short time, and then I had Darren Stockton also. And I think the season when I was working with Darren, I think we had won quite a few races that year, but I was still, that was the year I got, blew my leg out actually. Mm. And was kind of on the way up, you know, to like working that, you know, extra weight off or whatever, however you want to say it. And then I did this. And then obviously that was a hiatus that I had. And that's when at the end of outdoors, I still wasn't riding. Mm-hmm. And that's when James got rid of Eldon. And Paggio came to me, I think, right at Paula, basically, as they were parting. Mm-hmm. That was their last race. He goes, hey, this is happening, like, now, you know, letting you know so you can get on and get, you know, try to lock him in early before anybody else starts bidding on it, right? So, and that's what I did. What Padge came and said that, I was like, all right, well, if he's available, I didn't even ask what it was going to cost. I just mm-hmm. said, okay. So Eldon basically went, he didn't even have to look for a guy.
Yeah.
He already was hired.
Yeah.
Leaving Paula.
What percentage of your success from that point on would you credit Eldon with?
Oh, I mean, I'd say percentage wise, I'd say probably over 50. Or you could do it 50-50. Obviously 50% would be myself as a rider and 50%. The rest of that would be the team, you know, me and the team. Mm-hmm. And then as for the other 50 would be all of Eldon's program. In this industry and in this type of racing, as everybody knows, you can have a great bike and not be fit. You're still not going to win. You got to have all the pieces mm-hmm. put together in the puzzle correctly. And I think that's when that shift when I had made that shift and made that change, working with Eldon brought, you know, a whole different mindset to the table, really. Mm-hmm. A lot. I mean, everybody knows the diet and the training and things like that. Now, I think a lot of that has changed current day. You know, I think he's had to evolve. Like, you know, like he can't be doing the same thing I was doing back in 2010, 11, 12. Like that's old. That's old news.
Yeah.
Things are evolving. Bikes are getting better. Like the training's got to evolve and things like that. So, but at the time, that was the best, and I still think is the best for our riders or for our industry to, mm-hmm. to do that.
Do you think you have to be more fit now to race four strokes?
I don't think you have to be any more fit than when we were racing four strokes. Mm-hmm. No. But I think the biggest trend,
like everybody's fit now.
Like. Yeah, I think that's the thing. Evolution is like, you know, even your 10th place guy is has a pretty solid program.
Yeah.
You know, and you just look back to, you know, when I was racing, you know, you had the top, say, yeah, you know, eight that were, or five that were really fit. Mm-hmm. And then after five, it'd kind of drop off. Now it's like you go look inside that top 10. Well, you know, say Joey might not be as fit as Eli, but he's still doing way more than what 10th was doing back in 2010 yeah. or 11 or 12, and I feel. And plus the bikes have gotten better too. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I think it's just evolution of our sport.
You know, like fans will like guarantee you'll be on this show. People are like, oh dude, if RV trained for like 6 months, he'd come back and be the top 10 or a threat to win still. But I mean, do you ever compare yourself to the current guys and like mentally like think about like how fast you're going? And
I mean, I think you can, I think the boys were just watching some YouTube yesterday, and it was, I think, Washougal, Dunge one, I think. I was watching, and sure, I think that guys are, I don't want to necessarily say use the words that they're going faster than us, but I think things have just changed. Mm-hmm. Once again, we're seeing that most everybody inside the top eight now are 28, 29, 30, 31-ish.
Yeah.
You know, and honestly, I think that, Dunge retired at 27-ish, I was 27-ish, Ricky 27-ish, right around that same time, and I feel like these guys that have stuck it out and kind of gone through that really hard, that call it lull of our career towards the end of trying to make a decision, okay, I'm over this, should I retire? But we don't, you know, part of us doesn't want to retire.
Mm-hmm.
They've stuck it out through that, or maybe made a change in a team at that time of when they were feeling like retiring, like Eli, perfect example, at Cowie. It was like, okay, I'm done. And then, you know, he changed bikes, new goal, new color fender, new team. He can, I don't want to use the word demand more, but, you know, at his age and with the knowledge that he has, like you still have to really lean on your team and the engineers and all these things to make sure the bike's going to go in the right direction. Cause we're not engineers. We'll tell you what we feel. I think it's the right way to do it. In my opinion, is tell you what we feel and let's collectively make a decision, you know, but mm-hmm. ultimately like we're the rider and we need to let those guys do their job too. But I think being in Eli's position, having a little more horsepower behind him and being at that older age can, and really knowing what he wants too, I think you see the benefit in that now. Like I've said this on, I think, Race Day Live last A2, I was like, somebody asked, and I was like, I could say that I sit over here and say that I'm a little jealous that I didn't make that change, and good on him for making that change and prolonging his career another 2 to 3 years. While still having fun, not just making a switch and staying in that same old rut of where he was at Cowie. Like, I think that's a solid move, you know, and I think you can see that.
Guys, we're going to take one more quick break to hear from our sponsors. Back for one last segment with RV. Everyone, welcome back to the SML Show presented by OGIO Powersports and Yamaha Motors. Was there a point in your career when you were just like, F this bike, I don't like it, I wish it was different?
Never the bike. And I wouldn't say nothing in actual particular, just like looking back on it now, I think that if I would have had the option of moving, I never really had the option of moving. Yeah, sure, I had some other deals that came across the table, but they were substantially less money. And I wasn't going, it was too far apart to ever make a change.
Yeah.
You know, but as for looking back, you know, on my bike and career, like, sure, I think I still believe and feel that today, with all the different manufacturers that are involved, there's certain bikes that do certain things well and certain bikes that don't do certain things well. And as a rider, you have to be able to see that and work around it. And sometimes it's easier than others to work around that. Mm-hmm. The Cowie was, you know, super stable, had good enough power. It wasn't down on power anywhere, but there were some certain things that we did struggle with. Like, I had to ride that bike, it seemed like, a lot of outsides then more, like Dunger could go to the inside. And I could do it until to a certain point on the track before it got really a lot of acceleration bumps or certain things that made it tough for me to do that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, never once did I go back and be like, guys, we need to get this motorcycle to go up the insides of every turn and try to reinvent the wheel or change everything we had that was good. Because we might have been able to tackle that and make it turn better, but then what's the downfall to that? What are we going to see after that? Okay, we fixed this problem, but now maybe there would have never been a problem. And don't get me wrong, we were working on it. We worked on it a lot with the motorcycle, but I don't think the motorcycle, I wouldn't have changed. I just think the change that I would have needed or were looking for would have just been a new goal, new personnel. And I love everybody over at Cowie even today.
Yeah.
But just from a rider standpoint, trying something new and almost relighting that fire is more of what I should have done. But it wasn't anything in particular that is why I retired or wasn't having fun. You know, it was a bit of everything: schedule, racing, training, travel. You know, and I think all those things may have gotten, you know, funner if I would have had a new goal or something new to ride.
Was going to MXGP like that? Like, give me a new thing?
It was, but my head was already out of it before going. And there had been some things that were, I don't want to use the word promised, but, you know, like our bike was supposed to be as good or better than, and it wasn't. It was substantially not as good. We did make it better right before I got hurt. Motor-wise, we made it better. We were still struggling a little bit on the chassis. And I think one of the problems was, too, is when we went over, they basically was expecting me to walk through the door as, you know, 10-time, you know, Supercross, Motocross, Lights champ and be able to just dictate and tell them exactly what this thing should do, where it, you know, where it should be, how good it, you know, all these things where these are tracks I've never rode, personnel I've never dealt with, and more than half didn't speak a lick of English barely, you know, like they had words. So there was a lot going against us, you know. But like I said, ultimately, what really was the downfall to that was my head just wasn't in it, you know. So I did my best. I got to win a race. And it was a big feat going up against KTM on their own turf, you know. Yeah. And when I came over to Europe, it was literally us three. It was my wife and it was Tanner, my practice ride mechanic. And at the time in Europe wasn't practice ride mechanic. He was more gear, goggles, you know, driver, man friend, I guess you could say, in Europe. And it was us three traveling around with my practice ride mechanic, you know, during the week and things like that. So
looking back now though, do you go, it was a cool opportunity to go
It was
here, a there,
super
you
know? Awesome. It was. I mean, I wish it would have ended up different. And I'm not even meaning different in the way of winning a world championship.
You only got Qatar, Thailand, and Trentino,
yeah,
right?
Yep. Yeah. So not even looking back and saying, oh, I leaning on the side of the way of saying, oh, I wish I would have won the world championship. No, I just wish I would have won some more races and got to see more, you know, more places and just had a better showing, you know, top three. I, you know, sure, if you had asked me if I would have, you know, done that, finished that, how's third feel? I would have been like, ah, you know, but looking back now, it's been some time.
Yeah.
And I could say that definitely we were outgunned by a mile, but we still did good. Even with the things we were up against and then me mentally not really being in it.
Yeah. I don't know, man. It's like one of my, obviously I've traveled a bunch over the 30 something years I've been working like this. That Thailand trip is still one of the coolest memories. Like
it is.
Remember
that
we got in those tuk-tuks and we're going around looking for fake stuff.
Fake Louis Vuitton.
And crazy food.
Yeah. All the street food. Like it was an experience. Of a lifetime, and it was a lot of fun. I just, you know, I wish I could have been more set up a little bit better, even when it, as far as Europe, like I tell a lot of the, like initially, or even a few years after, they're like, well, yeah, like I'll be talking about our situation or where we're, our living situation or how it was going over there. And they're like, where'd you stay? I was like, oh, we stayed at, like a Center Parks. You mean like a, and it's basically like a glorified, like, Mulligans or whatever, that's got live-in residence type things, vacation rentals essentially, little apartments, and you park your car outside and have to walk in, like, and they're like, there's no way. And I'm like, yeah, that's where we live. They couldn't believe that's where we, because like we couldn't rent a house in Belgium. It's just like the, it's not like a European coming to the States where, hey, I just want to rent a house off you know, Greer, get a house. It's like, and you're in, like, it's like you got to register with the city and pay taxes and this and that. It's a very complicated system over there. So that was the easiest thing for us to do coming, you know, blindfolded. Now, you know, race into it, when I met Nick Sannon, which was Nikki Hayden's, like, you know, call it man friend, guy that would travel with him. His dad's the one that supplies all the motorhomes for MotoGP, all the American style motorhomes. Well, if I would have met that guy prior to being all set up, kind of, he's like, I could have had cars, houses, you'd live, you know, like, right. So the whole thing, you know, could have been definitely better. And that's where I say that like the guys at Cowie and or the KRT, the team, I think they relied on me too much. Think, you know, coming over as a champion, thinking this guy's got it all figured out, when that was so far from the case.
Was that bike like worlds different than what you raced?
It wasn't different. We had the opportunity to run a hydraulic clutch, which was obviously different. I went away from it. I went back to a cable. We did testing between KYB and Showa. We ended up with Showa. You know, but no, it was very similar, but in very similar chassis wise, but our motor wasn't as good as our US spec.
Okay. Yeah. To this day, still, like, I'm so glad I went to Thailand. I got to see you win, right? Moto, you killed him.
So yeah. Well. Yeah. No, I wish I could have went 1-1, you know, looking back, but no, the experience was good to get a win, you know, to be able to say I got a MXGP win, and it was a long time in the 450 class before the last time that has happened. And who knows when it'll be next. So I think that ultimately it was a great experience. Wish it would have went different, but also a lot of that was on me mentally not being there. I think that if I would have been earlier in my career or mentally would have been where I was, say, a year ago or 2 years ago, that even with the hurdles that we had in front of us with living and all the new, everything new, I still think I would have done better if mentally, if I would have been engaged.
I know. Well, hey, buddy, we're out of time, but thanks for coming on again.
No worries.
And I'll definitely have you on probably sometime not in the
not
so distant future. But anyway, guys, thanks for checking out the Swapmoto Live Show, and we'll see you next week.